thank the hospital foundation and Dr. K.S. Rao for giving me the opportunity to speak on the my topic on pathology of hepatic biliary system. This is a simple confidentiality disclosure statement saying that whatever opinion I am expressing here is of my own and I am not representing the company to which I am working. It is not my company's opinion. This is the outline of my presentation. It will be having introduction, anatomy and histology of liver, assessment of hepatotoxicity, clinical chemistry, gross pathology, organ wide histopathology, and some case examples we can discuss if you have time. Coming to the liver function, we, as you all know, it is very important organ for the toxicity studies, since it is organ where the detoxification occurs and the biotransformation of the drugs what you dose occurs here, and there is a bile drainage where if there is any recirculation of bile recirculation if it occurs, then the drug will be recirculating and you will not get then you have the blood glucose regulation and synthesis and storage of amino acids, proteins, vitamins and fats. This is the structure of the a normal rat liver. It is a reddish mahogany brown and with a soft and friable consistency, and it is smooth, it has a smooth capsular surface. Coming to the gross anatomy, this is to show the this is the rat mouse. We usually they take the left lateral lobe and the right medial lobe for examination along with the caudate lobe. This is optional according to the Gorini publication. And in rats we take the left lobe and the right lobe. As you all know, the gallbladder is not present in rat, horse and elephant, and there is gross subdivisions of the liver into is different in different species, and there is also vascular variation between the lobes. Coming to the blood supply, whenever you cause any drug, almost the entire drug enters the portal vein and it goes to the liver for biotransformation or are there. So as you can see here, in small intestine the drug enters here into the portal vein, it enters into the liver, and it then it enters into the ear, all the biotransformation occurs, the compound may become toxic or any metabolite may be produced and can be excreted through bile, or it may happen like that, and it may enter, then it enters into the hepatic vein. And to describe here, the hepatic artery, it gives only the 30% of the blood flow to the liver, and it provides 60% of the oxygen, whereas the portal vein, 70% of the blood supply is provided by the portal vein, and the 40% of the oxygen, that is the partially deoxygenized oxygen, will be provided by the portal vein. So we have dual blood supply for the liver. Coming to the histology, this is the normal liver hepatic cords you are seeing here. And here it is the, you are seeing the portal triad, you are seeing the hepatic vein, the bile duct, and the artery here, hepatic artery, and the lymphatics here. These are the different components what you see in histology. This is the sinusoidal cells, which are the endothelial cells you are seeing here in the liver, and this is the Kupffer cell, which are the resident macrophages, which engulf any foreign materials or any pigments which are the product of the biotransformation. This is the hepatic stellate cells. These are very important because they are the responsible for fibrosis. If you see any fibrosis, then that is the end stage. The liver cannot regenerate. So they form about the 50% of the resident liver cells, and they are tissue specific with the potential to regulate blood flow, and they are long cytoplasmic processes, and they contain retinoids. This is the EM photograph to show the retinoids here. That is the lipid you are seeing here, and this is the hepatic stellate cells, or they are also called as cytocells. This is to show the bile canaliculi. These are the bile canaliculi through which the bile flows and enters the bile duct. These are the bile, biliary epithelium, and the bile is composed of bile salts, cholesterol, phospholipids, bilirubin, water, and electrolytes. And you find villus recirculation of bile acids. As the bile enters through bile acids to the bile duct into the intestine, again it gets absorbed back into the liver through the portal vein and gets recirculation. If there is any recirculation of the drug, then the exposure will be more. Coming to the functional structure of the hepatic parenchyma, this is the most important part. This is liver acini. This is the portal triad here, and this is the central vein, and this is the zone 1, and zone 2, and zone 3. This is the classical liver lobule, where you have three portal triads forming a lobule, and this is the liver ulcinus. This is portal lobule. This is to show the histology, where you are seeing the hepatic lobule here. This is the central vein here, and this is the hepatic ulcinus here, the portal triad here, and the two central vein here. As you can see here, this is the part where zone 1, zone 2, and zone 3. Zone 1 is around the portal triad, and zone 2 is between the central vein and the portal triad. Okay. To know the importance of these zones, in zone 1 you have 9 to 13% of oxygenation, oxygen is there present, whereas in the zone 2 there is less than 1%, and in zone 3 that is 4 to 5%, and zone 3 is the most important thing, that it is having the wire transformation enzyme, that is the SIBS. And the zone 1 periportal area that I have shown you, that is having more oxygen and is also having GSH, that is the glutathione and the glutathione peroxidase. So this area is not more less susceptible to the toxicants, whereas in the zone 3 we have decreased oxygen levels and increased peroxidases, which biotransformate the drugs, and there is a decrease in the GSH glutathione transferase. This is to show the different cells which you are seeing in the liver, like hepatocytes, biliary, epithelium, endothelium, sinusoids, lymphatics, Kupffer cells, hepatic stellate cells, and progenitor. These are oval cells which are the stem cells, what you see in the rodents. It is equivalent to the hepatoblasts you see in the humans. And you have smooth muscle cells, mesothelium, nerves, hematopoietic cells, blood, and extracellular matrix, which account for 5 to 10% of the collagen. Coming to the clinical chemistry, this is what is recommended for clinical chemistry of particularly for hepatotoxicity. For hepatotoxicity, mainly we will go for ALT, that is alanine aminotransferase. It is a cytosolic enzyme, which is a leakage enzyme. Whenever there is any damage to the hepatocytes, the leakage will increase, and it will increase the amount of this enzyme present in the enzyme in the circulation. Then there is a sorbitol dehydrogenase, but it has a very short life, so it is usually not seen, but it is very specific for hepatocellular injury. And we have AST, lactate dehydrogenase, and total bile acids. Okay, for hepatobiliary toxicity, the enzymes you have to consider are ALP, that is alkaline phosphatase. Fairly, it is ubiquitous in the membrane and brush border, and it is seen in bone and placenta, and it is a good marker for cholestasis, and minimal increase is seen in hepatocellular damage. But this ALP in rodents, especially in rats, the amount of ALP produced by intestine is more when compared to the liver, so it might not be very useful in rodents. And the other one is 5-nucleotidase and the total bile acids. This is relatively sensitive marker for cholestasis. And the final one is the bilirubin, direct and total bilirubin. Total bilirubin, it will direct from the cholestasis. If you see any cholestasis, then you will increase in the total bilirubin is there. Indirect, it is due to the hemolytic disease. Measure of total and direct, measure of total and direct, and determine the, you have to measure both and subtract to get the indirect bilirubin values. This is about the ALT. It is the greatest activity in hepatocytes, so it is very good marker for hepatocellular toxicity. Its biological half-life is for 48 to 60 hours. It is induced in glucocorticoids, And it is very specific, so it is for epidural injury, induction, and muscle injury. And it is decreased by enzyme inhibition by cyclosporine. Coming to SDH, as I told before, it is having less short life, so it is not usually used, but it is also not stable, but it can be stabilized by refrigerated. And it is known to cause a severe increase in epidural injury or leakage. It is a good indicator, but the shortcoming is that it is having very good, very short biological half-life. Since you will be dosing the animal in the previous day and the next day, after almost 20 or 24 hours, you will be taking the blood samples. If there is any increase in sorbitol deiotinase also, you can't detect. Then we coming to AST, it is seen in numerous tissue, it is not very specific. The biological half-life of this enzyme is for 15 to 24 hours. And is used in the past to detect hepatocellular injury, and still used in large animals. And is mainly seen in muscles and RBCs also. If there is any artifactual hemolysis also, there will be increase in the AST levels. Coming to ALP, this is the greatest activity you see in liver, bone, intestine, kidney, and placenta. The biological half-life and the isolates of different tissues are highly variable. Can be induced by glucocorticoids. It is mainly seen in dogs, and it is also seen in the induced by phenobarbital and ALP. It is increased in cholestasis whenever there is in bile duct damage and drug induction, and increased in the osteoplastic activity and in cancer. Here, if there is any decrease in the feed intake, especially in the rats, since in rats ALP is contributed mainly by intestines, if there is any decrease in the feed intake, the amount of ALP what you see in the table should be very less, which we can correlate to the decreased feed intake. Coming to the bilirubin, we have a direct and indirect bilirubin. Direct bilirubin is the a conjugated one, that is conjugated with the bile salts. These are the breakdown of hemoglobin, and the direct, there is conjugation carried out by the liver. Increased indirect is mainly due to increased hemolysis, decreased hepatic uptake, and increased direct is due to cholestasis. Total bile acids, it is produced by liver, and the two important bile acids are folic and quinodeoxycholic bile acid, and the taurine or glycine conjugated are secreted into the bile. The intestinal bacterial modification produces deoxycholic and dilithiocholic acids. The increased, it is mainly increased in cholestasis, decreased hepatic uptake and hepatic injury. It is decreased in altered hepatic recirculation. Whenever there is an alteration in the enterohepatic recirculation, they will find the decrease in the total bile acids. Coming to the interpretation of clinical chemistry for the hepatotoxicity, mainly you have to look into the reference range. Mainly you have to look at the concurrent control always. Then you have to go to the historical control, and you should know the sampling interval, because some of the enzymes, the T-off is very short life, as I told for SDH, and some of the enzymes are increased due to the enzyme induction, like ALP, which is induced by phenobarbital barbiturates. And you should consider whether it is produced by induction or cellular damage. And you should also look for the magnitude of change when compared to the concurrent control. The usual gold standard is, if you find more than two-fold increase in the hepatocellular injury markers, they consider as adverse. Whether the alteration is single or multiple analytes, you have to correlate with that. And correlation should always be done with the clinical signs, if any, or with the organ weights and the histopathology. Coming to the gross pathology and organ weight, this is to show the hepatomegaly. When you see the enzyme induction, you can see the increase in the size of the liver. This is another photograph to show the hepatomegaly. You can clearly see the size of the liver has increased. For the liver, you should always take the relative weight, relative to the body weight. Always you have to consider for interpreting the data. The liver weights, because liver weight is directly proportional to the body weight. If there is an increase in the body weight, there will be a proportional increase in the liver weight also. If there is any decrease in the liver weight, there is a proportional decrease in the liver weight. So you have to take the relative weight to body weight of this liver while interpreting the data. Coming to the histopathology. These are the common lesions what you find in liver, which are cytoplasmic alterations like glycogen deposition or depletion, fatty change, pigmentation, degeneration, cell death, apoptosis or necrosis or hypertrophy or cardiomegaly. Rarely we see atrophy, and inflammatory cell infiltrates and proliferative lesions will be seen. This is to show the glycogen content here. This is the normal glycogen what you see in the mouse liver. This is the what you see, the rarefaction of the cytoplasm here, that is the glycogen. When there is excessive accumulation of glycogen, you will see the complete rarefaction of the cytoplasm. Here the when compared to here you will not find any change in the means it will not the glycogen content in the cytoplasm, it will not push the nuclei to the end. Whereas in the fatty chain, there will be pushing the nuclei to the end, and it will give a signaturing appearance. This is glycogen depletion. If the animal is in an inanition or it has decreased feed intake, you will say there will be no glycogen. And sometimes they will misinterpret this as hepatocellular atrophy. To tell the importance of fasting, when you do normal fasting, this is the normal histology what you give. If you don't do the fasting, there will be increase in the cytoplasmic glycogen level in the liver. So all the animals from control to all the test groups should be fast uniformly, otherwise there will be differences between the two, and increase in glycogen interpretation will be difficult. This is the fatty change where there is accumulation of fat in the hepatocytes, and they push the fat content has pushed away in nucleus. Here you can see the classical signetic appearance here. This is the microvesicular fatty change, and here you are seeing the microvesicular fatty change where you are seeing very small microvesicular vacuoles where there is no change in the morphology of the nucleus. Now the glycogen and fatty change, the glycogen usually we don't find any treatment related changes related to glycogen accumulation, but in some compounds which causes glucose accumulation which are used for diabetes, you may see some. But the fatty change, it is very commonly seen, is typically reversible, and we have macrovascular, it is usually due to the altered lipid metabolism. Whereas the microvesicular, it is possibly due to the mitochondrial effect. Combination of glycogen and fatty change is also seen sometimes, where the reading the slide and interpreting whether it is glycogen or fatty change is very difficult. In that cases, you have to go for the special stains for glycogen and fat. Like for glycogen, you can go for PAS, or for fatty change, you can go for maltate. Hepatic pigments, what you usually see, or the bile lipofuscin, which is the wear and tear pigment, or the hemoglobin or methemoglobin, or the drug-induced pigments. I will just show the pigments here. This is the Kupffer cell, which has engulfed the pigment here. You can see the pigment here. In this slide, you can see within the liver also you are finding the pigment. This is another photograph to show the pigment. This is slide to show the cholestasis. Bile accumulation you can see in the liver here within the cytoplasm, and here you can see it in the canaliculi. Coming to degeneration, commonly seen degeneration like atopic degeneration and the fatty degeneration. Before the word fatty degeneration was used, now the term used is fatty change or vacuolation. Here, you can see the fatty change here. The microvascular fatty change is here, but you can see the degeneration where the ballooning of the cytoplasm is occurring. Here also you can see the ballooning of cytoplasm of the hepatocyte you see. This is another photograph to show the atrophic degeneration here, where ballooning of the cytoplasm is seen. In general, pigment and degeneration are treatment related, and what we see, the cystic degeneration is normally not treatment related, it is a normal background lesion in rodents. Severity of the change is very important here, but when compared to degeneration, pigment, the reversibility, it will take more time. Degeneration, it is a reversible change. Then we have got to see that there are non-reversible change, that is apoptosis and necrosis. This is programmed cell death. You can see the fragmentation of the nuclei here, and here another one, and this is single cell necrosis. Most important is whether to call it as apoptosis or single cell necrosis. It is recommended to call as single cell necrosis because you need immunohistochemistry or other molecular tools to tell whether it is definitely that is it is apoptosis. This is definitely single cell necrosis. These three cells, this is the apoptosis. Whenever you see single cell necrosis or apoptosis, there is definitely increase in the ALT level and AST levels in clinical chemistry. Coming to the necrosis, this is multifocal necrosis. Whenever you see this type of lesion, then it is definitely adverse, and the people will not take up this compound further. Here you are seeing the centrilobular necrosis. This is the central vein around which you are seeing the centrilobular necrosis here. The amount of changes in the clinical chemistry parameters in ALT and AST is very high in this type of necrosis. Coming to the hypertrophy, this is the enlargement of the cytoplasm. You can see here around the central vein. In the hepatocytes around the portal area, you are not seeing any enlargement. Here in the enlarged photograph, you can see here the size of the hepatocyte is very small, whereas there is the enlargement of the hepatocyte cytoplasm. This occurs due to the enzyme induction due to CYP induces, where here you see this hepatocellular hypertrophy. This is the most common findings here, what you see in the drug development. This is EM photograph to show why there is hypertrophy. Hypertrophy, what you are seeing in the cytoplasm is due to the smooth endoplasmic reticulum proliferation. Here you can see the increase in the number of here this is the control where the amount of SCR is very small, where here there is more and there is proliferation. And then coming to this toxicology significance of enzyme inducers, whenever there is an enzyme induction which occurs, there may, if it is a very you can see increased degradation of hormones like thyroid hormones, or that there may be increased deactivation or activation of serum aromatics, because the CYP enzymes are induced by this drug. It will lead to increased deactivation or activation of the serum aromatics. In human beings, if you try two or more drugs along with the drug inducing enzyme, there may be altered metabolism of the drugs and may cause some adverse effects. Then coming to when as a enzyme induction should be considered as adverse. If you see only the hepatocellular hypertrophy without any other change, like any without any change in the clinical chemistry parameter, like increase in ALT or AST, then you can conveniently tell that it is a non-adverse adaptive change. Along with hypertrophy, if you see degeneration or necrosis or hypoplasia or bile duct hypoplasia or lipidosis or cholestasis, it is definitely adverse. This is to show in the where the, in this from enzyme induction inducing drug, where you are seeing the bile duct proliferation here, and here you are seeing the hepatocellular degeneration occurring here, and these are cells undergoing single cell necrosis or maybe apoptosis also. Although whenever there is a severe or excessive enzyme induction, this type of changes will be seen, and these are definitely adverse. Then later in the excessive injection also, you can see the cardiomegaly, where you can see the increase in the size of the nucleus. Or you can also see the increase in multinucleated hepatocytes also, you can see when there is a severe or excessive enzyme induction. Coming to hepatic enzyme induction, it is a common response to the xenomatic exposure, and it is considered as adaptive and non-adverse in the absence of indications of toxicity. It is no associated histopathology or not abnormal clinical chemistry. If you are not seeing, then you can tell it as non-adverse and adaptive change. It may cause secondary effects. As I told, it may cause thyroid adenoma, because since the thyroid adenoma is metabolized in the liver, and the amount of thyroid level, hormone level will decrease, and it will cause the follicular hypertrophy and hyperplasia of the thyroid, and it may lead to adenomas also. It can be adverse as well when it is associated with necrosis and apoptosis. And it can also cause, if severe excessive enzyme induction occurs, then it can cause, it can generate oxygen radicals and cause the tumors as well. This is to show the whatever I told you right now, that the induction of P450 enzyme may lead to formation of oxygen radicals and other electrophile reactive species capable of causing DNA damage, and it may lead to hypoplasia and degeneration, and it may cause polyploidy or uniploidy like cardiomegaly, and it may usually cause there is high probability of liver cancer in these studies. Coming to inflammation, whenever you use any terminology in toxic path, you should use the descriptive terminology, not the diagnostic terminologies like hepatitis or anything like that. You should use only the this type of terminology, that is descriptive terminology, where whether the inflammation is, which type of inflammation is there, whether it is acute, chronic, chronic active granulomatous or mononuclear cell aggregates, which are the common thing we have seen in the liver, and inflammation whether it is occurring in the peribiliary section or the last stage where there is fibrosis. This is the common finding, background finding in liver, multifocal inflammation or mononuclear cell infiltration. You can see 3 foci here. This is, we are seeing focal necrosis here and inflammation surrounding that. We are seeing the mononuclear cell infiltration here. This is the granulomatous inflammation where you are seeing the lymphocytes and the macrophages here. This is the end stage where there is a portal fibrosis. You can see the fibrous tissue proliferation around the bile duct. Coming to the proliferative responses, in liver you find pre-neoplastic lesions which are called as foci of cellular alterations. These are considered as pre-neoplastic changes where you, which are of different time, where you can see this is the clear cell type. In this type, there is a clear demarcation between the surrounding tissue and the surrounding normal tissue and the foci of cellular alteration. And you can see another clear cell foci here. This is the basophilic basophilic foci. And you can see the acidophilic foci here, and here another eosinophilic foci here. This is how the progression of liver from enzyme induction, it may go into the basophilic foci, it may be formed, and it may lead to hepatocellular adenoma, where the normal architecture of the liver lobule is lost, and there is, in adenoma, there will be a clear demarcation between the outside, usually encapsulated or clear demarcation between the normal tissue and other. Whereas in hepatocellular carcinoma, we will see there will be no clear demarcation, and there will be invasion of the neoplastic cell into the surrounding tissue, and if there is metastasis, it will enter into the mesentery or other tissues. This is to show the bile duct hyperplasia here. It's a very important lesion. If the any compound is showing bile duct hyperplasia, then it is very, if the compound may not go further. And similar thing is the whole cell proliferation. You can see the whole cell proliferation here. These are the stem cells, what you see in the rodent, which are the stem cell for the hepatocytes. This bile duct hyperplasia and whole cell proliferation occur together usually. These are some case studies. If you have time, you can discuss. Here you can see the ALP level. The normal reference level is 250 to 350, and the level is decreased here. It is showing 157. This is mainly due to decreased ALP. This is from a rodent, from a rat study. So it is likely due to the decreased feed intake. Here you are seeing only increase in the ALT, where there is an increase of almost two-fold increase. In these cases, mainly you will see hepatocellular necrosis, that is single cell necrosis, or apoptosis, or hepatocellular degeneration will be seen. Other things like the total bile acids, total bilirubin, direct bilirubin, or ALP, other things have not increased. So the biliary epithelium is normal here. In this case, there is increase, there's almost tenfold increase in the amount of ALT here, and along with that, there is increase in the STG, the sorbitol dehydrogenase also, and increasing the seeing in the increase in the bile acids. In these cases, we will see extensive necrosis in the liver. There is multifocal necrosis, not the single cell necrosis which I have shown, and there may be total bile acids increase also will be seen in this, increase will be seen in such type of necrosis. In this slide, you can see there is increase in all the levels, where there is increase in ALT, STH, ALP, TBA, total bilirubin and direct bilirubin. In this case, there will be increase in multifocal necrosis in the liver and bile duct hypoplasia and bile duct degeneration. And sometimes you can see oval cell proliferations also. These are the different references which can refer for hepatotoxicity. The most of the slides what I picked up is from the Robert Mannantrott website. Thank you. If you have any questions, you can ask.
You can take questions.
Sometimes we will see the alterations in the ALT and AST.
Okay.
Without any changes in the histopathology of the liver. Mm-hmm. So until which fold it is considered non-adverse, and until we, and more than which fold it is considered toxic.
Usually up to two fold they consider it as non-adverse. More than two fold they consider as adverse.
And one more thing you are saying about this enzyme induction. Mm. In almost all cases, we can see this hepatocellular hypertrophy, or in some cases, we might not see.
No, in all cases, you will not see. If there is excessive induction only, you can see in the microscopic level. You will definitely see in the liver weights, there will be increase in the liver weight.
Okay. So, what will be the fate of molecule if you are seeing a decrease in this TK profile on, means we are seeing the decrease in concentrations on day 14 and compared to day 1, and we are seeing this enzyme induction. So what will be the fate of molecule, whether we can carry it forward with the further studies, or whether we need to stop?
You have to see what change you are getting. Only if you are seeing only the hypertrophy without any other adverse changes, you can carry on the study to the next level. Otherwise, if you see any changes in the hepatic necrosis, or if you see any changes in the clinical chemistry parameters, then it is definitely adverse, and you have to take call whether to take it forward or not. It also depends upon the what is the safety margin for you, of your molecule, which is the toxic dose and what is the efficacy dose.
But here the concentrations are falling down on day 14, so it is not of concern. We are seeing the decrease of concentrations over a period of time, so whether we can carry it forward.
Decrease in concentration of the drug in TK?
Yeah.
You can carry on, because if you are not seeing any adverse change in that, then you can go on.